to laud the organizers at the end, but I think maybe we'll take a moment now just to thank everybody. Jean-Patrice Martel for being our leader and being a large contributor to the whole day today as well, the unsung hero of this conference. We have Mike Wilson, who played a significant role, Paul Patskou as well, who we'll introduce more formally in just a moment's time. Aubrey Ferguson, boy oh boy, if it was an unsung hero award there too, the bulwark of the day-to-day was done by Aubrey, and you can never thank him enough. And Lloyd Davis as well. So terrific group of people who put this day on for you all. All right. Well, I'm going to take you back just post the Second World War. In 1951, there was a tragic young hockey player by the name of Bill Barilko. He wasn't tragic at that point, but Bill Barilko was a terrific hockey player, as we know. By the time 1951 had come along, he had won 4 Stanley Cup championships in 5 years, part of that first dynasty that we've referred to a couple of times through the course of the day today. So we're going to talk about that first dynasty, and in doing so, I'd like you to meet one of the key members of that team, a rookie that year as well, Danny Lewicki. As much as we talk about history, we're going to talk about mystery here today, too. Dan Donohue has got one of the great stories of hockey lore. Dan Donohue. And then a man who bridged all of this together, including Danny's role and Dan Donohue's role, and helped us solve a mystery, not us, helped them solve a mystery as well. You know him as well. His name is Paul Patskou, one of the foremost archivist as far as video goes and history goes around. Paul Patskou, terrific. So what we're going to do, I'm going to start off with you, Danny, if you don't mind. Fort William was wild and woolly back in the day, but you were a terrific hockey player on those outdoor rinks. And in fact, by the time you were a teenager, were likely the most lauded player in the entire country at that point. I know it's a bit of a longer story, but I'd love you to tell us and just enthrall us with the story of how you ended up with the Toronto Maple Leafs from Fort William.
I had a coach that I played for by the name of Leo Barbini, and he was kind of a scout for Providence Reds at that time. And when I was 16, he said, you know, you should go to Providence Reds training camp. It'd probably be good experience for you, and you've never been anywhere else but, you know, playing in Fort William, Port Arthur. So I thought, well, yeah, okay. And they were training in Sherbrooke, Quebec at that time. So he said, in order that you go to camp, he said, they want to make sure that you show up, and they'll even pay you $100. And I thought, wow, and we were very poor in those days. So $100 was a lot of money to us. You know, I could give to my mom and take us for a month or two for eating. But anyway, I didn't realize that I had signed what they call a C form. And the $100 was a payment for it. And at that time, they had 3 different forms. One was an A form, which all it said, if you signed it to paper with the club, that you'd go to their training camp. The B form said that you'd go to their training camp, and if and when you're going to turn pro, you would give them the first option to play for them. The C form said, and unknowingly, that when you turn 18, you belong to that club that you signed with, and they tell you where to play, who to play with, whatever, or you're suspended, one or the other. And I was duped into finding the C form, unfortunately, and it really hurt me during my career. There's no doubt about that, because when I what happened was, they had a scout in Fort William, and he was a head scout for Toronto in those days. His name was Squib Walker. And he came over to the house one day and wanted me to go to Toronto, play the Toronto Marlies, and sign, you know, a piece of paper, and he gave me $100. But what he did, he brought in a pile of $1 bills and piled them up on a table in the kitchen. My mother looked at him. She didn't speak English at all. She was from the Ukraine. And she said, what is all this money doing on the table? And I said, well, he wants me to go to Toronto to play hockey. She took a broom and threw him out of the house. She said, no one's taking my son on me. So that was it. But then, meanwhile, what they did do is, I think he must have made a deal with Squib Walker, this Leo Barbini I'm talking about, and Providence, because a year later, I was bought by Toronto Maple Leafs from Providence for my rights, and they gave Providence $35,000 and a player by the name of Jackie Hamilton, and that's how I got to Toronto. Now, I played, came after we won the Memorial Cup in 47-48. I went to Stratford with my coach, Leo Barbini. He got the job coaching there. And at this time, I still hadn't realized that I had signed a C form. But however, it came out later on. If you want me to go on with it?
Sure, yeah, absolutely. Okay, well,
because what happened was I played the 1 year in Stratford, and they were quite good to me and treated me very well. And they wanted me to stay for the next year. And I was only 17 years of age then. And Toronto told me that if I didn't come to Toronto, I would be suspended. So they asked me whether I would go to court about the C form, because the C form in reality was a form of slavery. You know, no one ever thought about it that way, but it was a form of slavery. And many, many, many hockey players signed C forms not knowing what they signed. They got $100 and they signed, their career was with the club that they signed for, and that was it. There was no way out. But I said, well, and they were so kind to me, and the president of Cradler Manufacturing said, we'd like to take it to court, which they did. They took it, actually my case went to Parliament. And I was suspended, and back and forth they argued that I shouldn't be suspended. I was suspended, whatever, but in reality they did suspend me for 2 months. And then finally Stratford said, well, we're hurting your career, so I guess we better let you go to Toronto, or otherwise, you know, you're going to be ruined as far as hockey goes. So I went to Toronto to play with the Toronto Marlies. So when I went to Toronto, Mr. Smythe called me up to the office, and he was, well, to say strict would be being kind. He was an army man. He was very, very tough, and he did his way or no way at all, and that's all there was to it. So when I went up to his office, I was shaking like a boot, you know, and we had no agents in those days, anything like that. So he looked at me and he said, you are nothing but an impertinent brat. I didn't know what the hell impertinent meant, for Christ's sake, at that time. What's it going to take for me to sign you? And I said, well, I said, I would like $10,000 a year to play and $7,500 to sign. He said, $7,500 to sign and $10,000? He said, my star player with the Toronto Maple Leafs doesn't get $10,000. He said, here's what you're going to get. He said, $7,500. You'll get $3,500 to sign the contract. If you don't like it, go back to Fort William and dig ditches. I looked at him and I said, Mr. Smythe, where's the pen? So that was how I got to Toronto.
Well, so few people would ever stand up to someone like Conn Smythe, and certainly not at a junior level, certainly not without your parents sitting there as well. Danny, what gave you the impetus to be able to stand up to such a formidable hockey person?
Yeah, well, I guess I was never a yes man, if you want to put it for you know, kind of words into that. But I, inside myself, I felt very badly that I was duped to signing something I didn't know what I was signing for. And it was really a form of slavery. And I thought, well, maybe we could get a change, but I didn't realize the problems it was going to cause. Because I know that Mr. Smythe never forgave me for fighting the C-form. And especially because my case went to Parliament. And actually, the C-form was absolved, I think about, well, what, 7 years later, was it? Something like that? From 1950?
The 60s.
Yeah, somewhere in the early 60s. So many of the players that are playing today in the National Hockey League don't even realize, you know, who was behind having the C-form abolished. And in many ways it made me feel good, but in many ways it also hurt my career with Toronto, because I know for a fact that Mr. Smythe never forgave me. There was no doubt about that.
Wow.
Yeah.
You joined the team in 1950-51, terrific team at that particular time too, but you had the amazing feat on your resume already to already have won a Memorial Cup, an Allen Cup, and subsequently a Stanley Cup as well. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, 47-48, we won the Memorial Cup. Actually, here in Toronto, at the Maple Leaf Gardens, we played off against the Barrie Flyers that year. We were the underdog, and we came down here, and we won the series in four straight games, believe it or not. And the last game actually went into overtime. The fourth game went into overtime, and I scored the winning goal in overtime. But I was the leading scorer during that series in 47-48. And then when I came to the Marlies in 49-50, our junior team, the Marlies, got knocked out of the playoffs by Windsor. And at that time, the Toronto Marlboros had a senior team. So they picked up George Armstrong and myself to come up to play with the senior team as the playoffs were just starting. So we got into the playoffs, and we played in Ontario against Kitchener to start with, and then to Northern Ontario, and then from there to Eastern Canada. I think we played in Sherbrooke against the Sherbrooke, I forget the name of the team.
Was it Caspers?
At that time, yeah. And then from there, we went out west to play for the Allan Cup, and it was against Calgary. And we played, I think it was two games in Calgary, two or three, and then two in Edmonton for some reason. They moved the series around, but we won that series as well. And I felt very proud of two things at that time. I was the leading scorer during the Memorial Cup playoff all the way through, and I ended up being the leading scorer for the Allan Cup in 49-50. In fact, I think it was one game we played in Calgary. We beat them 3-1. I scored all three goals. And I remember coming home, my brother gave me a big headline from the Toronto Star and their sports page. It said, Lewicki 3, Calgary nothing. And I'm very proud of that, yeah. And then, of course, when I turned pro with Toronto, I had Max Bentley as our center iceman, Joe Kluge as a right winger. I was a left winger. And we got off to a pretty good start. And I was battling throughout that season. I was battling Terry Sawchuk for the Calder Trophy that year. And I had 16 goals with 12 games to go. And we had a practice at the Western Arena one day for a bunch of schools. And the place was jammed with school kids. And someone threw a paper clip on the ice. And apparently the way I could skate, I hit the paper clip and I tore my groin to all the hell. And that cost me any chance as far as the Calder Trophy was concerned, because I missed the last 12 games, and up until then, I had 16 goals, which, as you know, probably a 20-goal scorer in that era was looked upon as a pretty good hockey player. So I was almost certain I would have scored at least 20 with 12 games to go. And unfortunately, with the injury, I missed all the 12 games and didn't get back in shape until the final started. And even when the final started, I was called up to the office one day by Smythe, and two doctors were there. And Mr. Smythe said, how is his groin? Is it healed properly, everything else? And then one doctor said, well, he said, I would say 95 to 98% healed, but the only problem is, if he ever hurt it again now, you know, it could hurt his career down the line. And Mr. Smythe said to me, stand up. I stood up and he said, pull your pants down. I thought, what the hell's going on here? And I had to listen to him, you know, he was the boss and whatever, so I threw my pants down. And he said to the doctors, look at him. He said, he's got legs like a thoroughbred. If he can walk, he can skate. He said, tape him up, he's playing. That was it. And that's what they did during the series. I'd be taped up before every game to help with the groin. But I didn't, you know, didn't do any good. It did good as far as the skating, but it hampered the way I could skate. But my main job at that time was to make sure that your winger or whoever else doesn't score a goal while you're on the ice. And that was my job during the playoffs.
And did so well. That team was very close-knit, as I'm to understand. Harry Watson and a number of veterans, but there were a lot of younger guys, too. You'd be included in that, too. Can you talk about personal relationships, some of the things that you did as a group, some of the best friends that you had on the team, and maybe you can specifically add a little bit about Bill Barilko.
Well, very, very much so. We were very close-knit, and I'll tell you, after a game on the weekend, every Monday after the weekend was over playing, we would meet as a team, and everybody met. One time in the West End, and some of the players who live in the East End, and the next Monday, we would meet at a restaurant in the East End. And this went on, and Teeter Kennedy was the one who put this together, and he was a real great leader, no doubt about it, an inspirational type of captain. And Brilko and all, and many of the guys, like, you know, didn't drink in those days. Some did, some didn't. Teeter never drank, never smoked. I never drank in those days, you know, just I was only 19 years of age. I still had a year junior left, by the way, in 1950-51 when I turned pro. And it brought everybody close together, you know, Harry Watson, Cal Gardner, Sid Smith, Brilko, Jusda, Fernie Flamin, all the guys. This knit everybody close together, and the meeting, the once every Monday after the weekend games. And we went that way right through the whole season, I think. One of the reasons why we have such a great hockey team and won the Stanley Cup because of that. I don't know what they're like today, you know, whether they have that opportunity to do the same or not, because they, but I understand now they have agents and, you know, they're so busy with everything else. But that's the way, you know, we got through that season. And then the next year, of course, I went back to camp, and Mr. Smythe didn't like the fact that I got married. So we started out the season, and I wasn't playing too much to start off, and I couldn't figure it out with the year I had and whatever, and I was still playing with Max and Kluke, but every once in a while I'd be on a bench sitting. And so after about 6 or 8 games, and I had to find an apartment in Toronto, and I found one out in the Lakeshore, and they have to sign a lease. So in those days, you paid the first month of the first year and the last month in advance. So I went to Joe Primo, who was our coach, and I said, Joe, I'm not playing very much. I said, then I'm supposed to sign a lease for this apartment that I want to rent. Do you think I should sign it? Because, you know, what do you think? Oh, he said, don't worry about it. I said, sign it. He said, you'll be here. I said, fine. Signed the contract. But 4 days later, I said, Mr. Smythe would like to see you up in the office. So I got up in the office, and he said, we're sending you down to Pittsburgh. I said, I beg your pardon? He said, we're sending you down to Pittsburgh. He said, you're not playing well. I said, Mr. Smythe, I said, how can I play well when I'm on the bench? He said, that's beside the point. He said, you're not playing well because you're lying in Fertile Valley too much being married. Well, what the hell that had to do with my playing ability? I have no idea. But anyway, I went back to the department and I refused to go. And about 4 days later, and I wouldn't answer the phone. I didn't go to back. I just didn't have anything to do with him. So finally, he sent over a fellow that I boarded with when I was a junior in Toronto, and to see me and to talk me out of staying at home and not reporting. So I finally went back to Toronto and went up to his office, and he said, "Why won't you go to Pittsburgh?" And I said, "Well," he said, "you know, this is why." They said, I asked Mr. DePrimo whether I should sign a lease for this apartment that I have, and because I was worried about maybe being sent on the visitor, wasn't playing much, and he told me go ahead and sign it, and I did, and I said I had to pay the money up front. He said, is that all that's bothering you? And I said, yes, sir. He said, well, I'll tell you what. He said, you go down to Pittsburgh. He said, you come back to this team if you belong here, if you are good enough to make it back here, and I'll buy you any house in Toronto that you want. And I thought, holy shit, you can't beat that. So I said, yes, sir. So I went down to Pittsburgh, and in 3 weeks, I scored 17 goals, and he called me back to Toronto. So one day after, first day after practice, I said, Mr. Smythe would like to see you. I said, yes. So I called him, said, I have a couple of homes, he said, that I built, and he had at that time had a big gravel pit, and after that was done with, he had another one across the road, so he built all homes in that gravel pit that was all gone. And then in that area, Turk Broda lived, and Gus Mortensen bought homes from him in that area. So he said, there's 2 homes for sale there, take a look, and if you like one, let me know. So I looked at this couple of houses, there's one right across from Turk, and it was right on a corner, it was a nice home. So I said, I like this home at the corner, I said, right across from Turk. He said, oh, he said, what are they asking for? I said, $12,500. He said, well, he said, I built that home. He said, they're asking too much. He said, I'll get it for $11,500 for you. I said, yes, sir. So he called me up 2 days later and a bunch of papers, said, I have this house. He said, sign these papers here, and you have this house and whatever. I said, yeah, thank you very much. He said, and by the way, he said, can you live on $75 a week? I said, I beg your pardon? He said, well, I bought the house for you. He said, now you got to pay me back. And I went to that year, and the following year after, that's the third year of Toronto, I guess he was still mad at me about everything. So he sent me down to Pittsburgh, and I was buried there for 2 years. I was called up the odd time for games when someone got hurt or whatever. And at that time, King Clancy was our coach in Pittsburgh. So King, one weekend, they were off, Pittsburgh was off. So King came with me when they called me up to series against Detroit. We had a home-and-home series Saturday in Toronto, Sunday in Detroit. And I scored 2 goals one night in Toronto and a goal and assist in Detroit. We won both games. So on the way back, King said, Danny, so I'll tell you one thing, I don't know what the hell you're down here for in Pittsburgh, but I'll tell you one thing. If I get to be coach of Toronto, he said, you'll be my man, you're coming with me. I said, well, thanks very much, King. The next year he got to be coach of Toronto, I got traded to the New York Rangers.
Well, so April 21st, 1951, Danny, you're on the team as well, and Bill Barilko scores the goal in overtime and wins the Stanley Cup with the Leafs against Montreal Canadiens. And it's a momentous time for everybody at that point. Years go by, and the puck is donated to the Hockey Hall of Fame. And it sat there for a long time, and the caption read that it was the Stanley Cup winning goal, and there was a stick there, there were jerseys there as well. But then the story emerged not all that long ago that there was another gentleman who actually believed that he had the puck that was the Stanley Cup winning goal. And wait a minute, the Hockey Hall of Fame's got one, and this gentleman, Dan Donohue's got a story, and it's tied to a puck that's tied to Barilko as well. And Dan, maybe you can take us through a little bit and bring Paul into the story too about how the story emerged and how you were able to prove that, in fact, the puck that's sitting in front of you right now was the puck that Bill Barilko used to score the Stanley Cup winning goal on Jerry McNeil.
Sure. Thanks, Kevin. Okay.
Yes, I'd love to share my story with everybody here today. Thanks for having me, Kevin. The puck has been in the family, I guess, since I can remember. My grandfather, he had a tavern in Hamilton, and he was, worked heavy, long shifts, long hours down there. He also had season tickets for the Toronto Maple Leafs, so that was his escape from work. We'd go down to the Leaf game and watch hockey. So at that time, when this game came up, the Stanley Cup game, 1951, he had a brother, Jerry, and they would take turns going back and forth with regards to hanging out with their dad. So it was my dad's turn to go to that game in 1951, the potential to win the Stanley Cup at that time. So off they went to the game, and of course, everybody knows what happened. Bill Barilko scores the winning goal just over McNeil's right shoulder and wins the Stanley Cup for the Toronto Maple Leafs. And everybody's going crazy in the gardens, and I guess my dad's sitting out there. And they're about 10 rows from the ice and between the blue and the center line. So as everybody's going crazy on the ice, my dad sits there and watching all the festivities on the ice, he looks over to his dad and says, "Hey Dad, can I go down and get the puck? It's just sitting there in the net." And everybody's off to the side celebrating. And my grandfather said, "Yeah, go ahead, see what you can do." So he goes down to the ice level, and then he's confronted by an usher. And he asked the usher if he could go on the ice and get the puck. And sure enough, the usher said, "Go ahead." So he climbed over the boards, walked out to the ice, reached into the net, pulled the puck out of the net, came back, climbed over the boards, went back to his seat. On his way back, one of the fans said, "I'll give you $20 for that puck." And my dad said, "No, I'll keep it." So, so that this is the puck here up here that Dad got out of the net that day. So what happened when they got back home that night? The next day, my grandfather called up a craftsman in Toronto and actually had that trophy made, and that puck sat in that trophy from ever since. And I can remember growing up with that puck and that trophy wherever we went, from house to house. It was always something that Dad would put on the mantle or in his office. And I can remember with my brothers when we were younger, we would play hockey in the basement with the actual puck, and not really having any idea what the puck actually represented. So all these years, the puck sat up with my dad, and nobody really paid too much attention to it. Not even my brothers. Well, I have three other brothers, and we never really knew what the puck really meant at the time. It wasn't until the passing of my mother that my dad started having friends over, all his buddies would kind of hang out at the house. And I would come by and I would wonder, why is all his friends so interested in the puck? What is going on here? And somebody even made me an offer for the puck. I'll buy the puck off you for, it was $100 I think he offered me for. But that kind of got my interest as to why everybody's interested in the puck. And then I did some research and I wanted to find out what the puck really represented. And it's an honor to be up here sitting beside Danny and telling you guys about the story.
So Paul, who is an extraordinary researcher, came onto the scene, and all of a sudden when he found out that there was some conjecture over which puck was which, decided he would go into the archives, and his video archives I'm talking about, and try and figure out, is Dan's story the story that is the actual story? Is there any merit to it? And Paul, maybe you can pick it up and talk about how you were able to add provenance to the puck.
I was sitting at home one day, and I got an email from Todd Deno. Now, Todd and I, we have this thing about, you know, proving things or disproving things. It's kind of fun to do, and we've done a pretty good job over the years. So I knew the Hall of Fame had the puck, and their story was that right after the goal was scored, Kevin, correct me, but the referee, Bill Chadwick, took the puck and he threw it over the boards to a kid in a wheelchair, and from there it made its way to the Hall of Fame a few years later, and they've claimed the puck. So then we hear the story about Dan and his dad going on the ice. Now, you would think that you'd believe the Hall of Fame story, not some story that came out years and years later where someone all of a sudden said, oh, I've got the puck. So the key thing here is, and anybody that knows me knows that I keep an open mind on things. I don't, you know, say no to something automatically, even though I'm part of the Hockey Hall of Fame. So, and I don't want to, you know, discredit them. But the only way we're gonna know is looking at photos or video. Now, most people have seen the Barilko goal. There's two or three versions of it, different camera angles, but it sort of stops after the goal is scored, and there's, you know, they go to the players on the ice. And I thought, well, the only way we're gonna find out is if we see any film of the celebrations. And I had found this film, it was called Unidentified Hockey at the National Archives. And some years ago, I asked permission to retrieve it, and I did. And I got it was VHS at the time, and I'm watching it, and I can tell, well, that's Montreal, Toronto, and you can see Barilko, and we're number five. It's got to be 1951, so I keep watching it. Geez, it's the actual game that Leafs win the Cup. That's just incredible. No one even knows it's there. It's called Unidentified. Of course, it's the game film that Shannon McKenzie had shot. And it's, of course, it's got the game, but it kept going on, and it had the actual celebrations over, you know, I used to be 5-10 minutes of it, which is interesting because you see the flashes going off and the famous pictures you see of Bill being hoisted up, you see actually on the video. But you also see the Montreal, the Leafs going towards the, no, first of all, you look at the video and you see the referee, he doesn't pick up the puck and throw it over the boards. He skates right off the ice. Of course, I talked to the referee about that. I said, yeah, well, they just want to get to the beer quickly. So the Hall of Fame story right there is a little bit suspect. So now I've got to see, is there a way that we can find out if there's anybody on the ice that goes and picks it up to validate Dan's story? Well, I look at the Shannon McKenzie film, and darn it, if I don't see this figure going the opposite direction towards the net where the Leafs are going off the ice. So that's pretty intriguing. So this story has some merit now because I've actually got video that no one else has seen of probably Dan's dad going towards the net and picking the puck up. Now, Dan's done tremendous work. He's found a photo from the archives where the puck is still sitting in the net. So the Hall of Fame story is just not true. The real proof is that the puck that the Hall of Fame has wasn't even used that year. But there's another twist to this where, and I think Brian Costello of the Hockey News was watching, I didn't even notice it, where a second puck is thrown onto the ice while they're congratulating each other. And that's unusual. Nobody brings pucks to the games where if it was a puck that went into the crowd and it was thrown back on. I mean, who would do that? So that's due to. So the Barilko story keeps going on and on and on. So I'm pretty sure that because of the video evidence and the puck evidence, that this is the puck that Barilko actually scored with that and the Hall of Fame puck, well, is still on display at the Hall of Fame at the Centennial exhibit there. But even they know it, that it's not the real puck. So Eric?
This was, when I saw that in the hockey news, I sent that to Phil Pritchett, I sent it to Brian, this is sort of Frank Orr telling the story of how he recalls the original puck getting there, which doesn't mean this isn't it, because I believe this.
I have that in my presentation.
Dan's going to show it to you. This is going to be good, he's going to show it to you. Okay. To be honest, I can barely see 10 feet, but I can't
read it.
But if you could read it, that'd be great.
It's the same sort of story, but it's like it's a little bit different than what you said, but clearly if there were two pucks, this is how the other puck got there.
Well, that's
right?
Who got it all.
Jump it up. Yeah. So if it comes up, I'll
that's the other story that came out as well. And actually, if you don't, I think Phil sent it to me.
I never heard what happened. Like, I sent it to him, but I never heard back from either.
Yeah, actually, he sent it to me, and I actually have it in the deck here.
Yeah.
I want to see this. Like, they have a lot of things wrong, and they don't correct them. Especially dates of guys.
Now, I have spoke with Phil Pritchard and Greg Campbell. And they said that they are looking at the puck and putting together a display for it for in celebration of the 100-year anniversary for the Leafs. So we have not been touched since the beginning of the summer, but I'm assuming that we'll get together and actually go through and get set up that exhibit. But my view on this is that Paul's done a tremendous amount of work, and same with Hockey News, Brian Costello, and all the folks. You know, forward me information, and I've compiled a bunch of slides and a PowerPoint, which I can I'll take you through. And some of the stuff that Paul had talked about as well. I took some snapshots of some of the things that he had found, and I'll just take you through it. And you can make your own decision whether or not you believe.
No, I believe that. I just think this is interesting. This is a slightly different story. Paul tells it a little bit different, but clearly, if there's two pucks with that shows like this guy had the other puck, this one makes way more sense than the real
puck. But the puck that the other fellow was not even used at that time.
So if that's what was thrown on the ice, then that makes sense.
Sure, it does.
Well, why would someone have a puck?
Why would someone bring it on?
Bring it to the game.
Yeah, exactly. It makes no sense.
Can't figure this out.
Eric, the puck that the Hall has wasn't used, I believe, until 1957.
I'm going to show you right now with a puck.
Right.
Okay? All right. So this is a winning goal, as you can see, and Bill's winning goal over McNeil's right shoulder. And you can see very clearly, this is a picture that's actually in the executive office of the Hockey Hall of Fame at the top of the stairs. Moving onward, you're going to see the goal happening there, and you can see the referee on the bottom right there actually skating off the ice immediately after the goal is scored. So you don't see him reaching into the net, pulling that puck up and throwing it over the glass. If you, I took a work with the Toronto Archives. I worked with a gentleman by the name of Phil Gardner, and he actually pulled some photos that he didn't know he had, and he sent me the negative. As you can see into that net, you see the puck actually sitting there, that little white dot in the net, clearly showing that the puck is where it is, where my dad described it to be. And actually, we actually took that negative and we actually blew it up into a photo. And it's very clear. You can see that puck sitting there quite clearly, as my dad described. So I don't know, I don't see any referee around taking that puck out, throwing it over the glass. So you can see, immediately following the goal, you're going to see, as Paul mentioned, or as Brian Costello found, a second puck being thrown over the glass on the at the end there, in the corner. Hits the actual ice and just skates across the ice. And actually, you can actually see this video actually on the internet. If you could just browse up and do a search on that video, you actually can see the video. And this is one of the, one of the stories about how Jimmy Mayne actually gave the puck to his good friend Fletcher, who actually donated the puck. George Fletcher, 79, who was given the puck by Jimmy Mayne, and he was the guy who was in a wheelchair. Apparently, everybody thinks that he'd received the puck. And this is the puck that that George Fletcher had donated to the Hockey Hall of Fame. And you can see very clearly on that photo that puck is a Spalding stamp on that puck. No question about it, a white stamp. And you can see how badly bruised that puck is. It's chipped pretty good. This is a puck that's on display in the Hockey Hall today, and it matches up exactly with what with what Fletcher had donated. So it, all the stories are lining up, and they're kind of clearly articulating that this is a puck that Bill actually scored the other winning goal with. As Paul described, you can see that from his video, we took a snapshot. Paul took a snapshot.
Yeah, I took a screen grab of it, and I was following through. Now, I was surprised to see this. I didn't really think I'd find someone on the ice other than photographers. And at the bottom right there, you're going to see someone shuffling towards the net, and everybody's going the opposite direction. So that's kind of intriguing to me that, now we disproved the other theory, so somebody has to have the puck, and the puck is right here. And it's just amazing to me that we have Danny Lewicki here, who's in this building, who actually touched that puck back in 1951, and now he's here with that puck again. I think just this incredible. Yeah, and so Danny can identify it. He can talk about the second puck on there, or are you busy congratulating everybody on there? You see, the video is right there. We can't see it, but it's pretty interesting.
No, 21.
Does that spectator have a stick in his hand?
No. You see, it's kind of... the film back then, the film isn't exactly pristine like you would find now. Okay, and with camera speeds and things like that. So Shane McKenzie's filming this from the greens. And if you look at it closely, there's shadows and things like that. He doesn't have a stick, he doesn't have skates. He's shuffling towards there, if you see the video, okay? Now, nothing's definite, but there is someone there that's going towards the net with a purpose. And I believe that Dan's dad is doing that.
I can't, looking at that photo, I can't 100% say it's my dad, but, I can confirm it is a male. Short, dark hair, right, in a suit, and that's my stature. That would be my dad at that age, and I have some pictures at the end of the... PowerPoint, I'll show you which my dad looks like at that time.
The fact that anybody goes on the ice, the fact that anyone can go on the ice after the game like that, is incredible by itself. The story is so... Who would make such a story? You can't make it up,
yeah.
You see? But we have proof.
Okay, so this is a puck, as you can see up here. This is a puck, an Art Ross puck, from the 1950-58 era. And that puck was manufactured, and that puck does line up with the game, 1951. Makes sense that it's the pucks that they would have used in that game. You can see some research I found on the internet, and I provided them the bottom left there with regards to where I found the information. And basically what it is, it's the usage of the NHL pucks throughout the number of decades. And you can see that the first era on the far left, you can see that the Spalding puck, 1920 to 1942, was the era that the Spalding puck was manufactured and actually used in the NHL seasons. And as you can see, moving along the years, when Art Ross got his pucks patent, you can see him using his pucks 40-42, and then therefore onward, those are all the Art Ross pucks. And you can see my dad's puck, or the pucks that were used in Danny's game, you can see the second arrow showing that the 1950-1958 era. So you can see it's quite a number of years difference why you would be using a Spalding puck, 10 years old, later on in an NHL game. It makes no sense at all. The other thing that doesn't make any sense, as well as a puck on display in the Hockey Hall of Fame, it's so badly beaten up, it's chipped. Why would you be using a puck of that nature, all chipped up, using it for a game? It doesn't make any sense. And this puck here, they scored 2 minutes and 58 seconds into the overtime goal. This puck is pretty well pristine, and it looks like it's pristine, too.
You just said you
played
with the puck yourself.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Oh, yeah, but no, for sure. Absolutely. Okay, and this is the two. These are the two pucks side by side. Big difference. And then just some references. This is my dad with the glasses, tall, thin, short hair, kind of lines up with the guy in the video. And actually, this is the actual article.
But it says that a Montreal Canadiens player in disgust kind of flipped the
defense,
which makes perfect sense when that puck lands at the feet of that
he could have easily, he could have easily flipped it up. And you're going to see right here, there's a puck, and there's a puck in the net, same, two pucks at the same time. And you're right, the NHL, the Canadian player could have easily swept that puck up into the over the boards. Wow. Debunking myths.
Evidence.
We have a question over here.
Could that Spalding puck have been a practice puck that went out into the stands earlier in the warm-ups?
Sure.
I mean, that's how it could have shown up there.
Yeah. I did speak with Richard about that and Greg Campbell, and exactly that. Anything's possible. Those pucks could have been sitting around. Anything's possible. Or a fan could have threw it out from the stands as well. Any questions on the presentation?
More?
Boy, oh boy. Wonderful.
Dad remember it all.
Well, Danny, do you remember that game specifically?
Well, of course, naturally. Not, it's about, let's say, well, about 70 years or whatever. However, memory's still not too bad. And one of the things that possibly people don't remember is that we went five games against the Canadiens, and every game went into overtime of the five games. I don't know whether everybody knew that or not. And in that last game, one of the things that people seem to forget, we were down one goal with a minute to go, and we pulled our goaltender at that time. And with about 30 seconds left, I think it was around 30 seconds, Paul, somewhere around there, Todd Sloan scored the tying goal. And I don't know whether many people remember that or not, because that's also as important as possibly, you know, Bill scoring the winning goal, because without Todd scoring that goal, we would not have been, you know, we'd have to go back to Montreal to play the next game. And with Bill, of course, he was a real character. He was a guy who liked to carry the puck for a defenseman, and he was always warned by Smythe about carrying the puck over the blue line, not making a play. Make a pass when you get over that blue line, or else I'm going to fine you $100. Well, Bill loved to carry the puck, you know, all the time. And either Ferdy Flamin, who was his mate, or Bill Jusda, they were the stay-at-home defensemen. And the other pair was Gus Mortson and Jimmy Thompson. Gus was like Bill Barilko. He liked to grab the puck and fly with it as far as he could and make a play whenever he thought it needed to be made. He would be warned about not carrying the puck too many times over the blue line, not making a play, or he would be fined $100. But thank God for Bill. You know, he was a guy that had a pretty good shot and unbelievable, you know. And the thing that I guess really made it more famous for him was that when he went away that summer fishing with his doctor up north and was killed in a plane crash. And at that time, when he was killed, missing, Mr. Smythe put a $10,000 reward as to anybody who found the wreckage and the bodies of Bill and the doctor. Well, that went on for almost a good year, and nothing was found. No one knew where they were. Nothing happened. And Mr. Smythe finally removed a $10,000 reward. About two or three weeks after that, that's when they discovered the plane where it was crashed and the skeletons of the two bodies. So that's kind of, you know, another story that goes along with Bill and the puck.
Fantastic. Thank you, Danny, for taking us back to the 1950s and a wonderful, wonderful time. Danny Lewicki, an outstanding book he's got as well. So take a look for his book, a great story of triumph over challenges. Dan Donohue, thank you for debunking a myth and adding some history and mystery to our day-to-day as well. And Paul Patskou, again, for reconfirming that there aren't any out there who are as good at you as you in this kind of research. Thank you all three very, very much.
Yeah.
All
yeah,
right.
It's just a great story.
Dan and Danny and Paul are going to take the artifact over to the my right, your left. You get a chance.